Paltrocast.
But Wednesday is my off day.
Yeah.
No practice for my kids. School gets out early. Usually Wednesdays are my days where I get to have fun. And Wednesdays are my Saturdays.
Wednesdays are my Saturdays. Wow. That sounds like the name from a memoir. But, you know, 15 or so years of everyone wanting to talk to you, because you go from MBA career with the foundation to now the wine career. When did it go from I like a glass of wine to, wait a second, I should be spending dozens of hours a week on this, and this is a career?
Well, dozens of hours would be nice if I wasn't the owner, right? If I wasn't trying to do something different, dozens of hours would probably be, you know, easy. I think it changed when I was deciding whether I was done or not with basketball.
Mm-hmm.
I think when you love wine and you live in Oregon and you're me, I thought, could I do this every day?
Mm-hmm.
Could I, you know, put my mark on the wine industry? Could I take something that I love and make it better? Obviously it's work. Obviously it's tedious, but work isn't work when you love it. And I think for me, after 3 years, I'm already starting to see the impact that we have at Chosen.
Mm-hmm.
I think people are asking more questions about wine. I think they're curious about wine. I think I've had amazing conversations with people about, well, wine seems so complicated. I'm like, do you like it? Yes or no? Like, you know, we did a tasting at a grocery store, you know, one of the grocery stores that our wines are in. And this lady was baffled by my answer when she said, what are the tasting notes? And I go, I don't know. I can't be in your mouth. What do you taste? Do you like it? Well, tell me what I'm supposed to be tasting. I can't do that. I can't tell you what you're supposed to be tasting. I think
if I could cut you off there, that is so unique to the wine industry, where everyone wants to pass off what certifications that they have, how many things that they've tried. And you just gave the most honest thing, like, hey, do you like it or not?
Do you like it?
Were you like that on day one? Or did you hit a level at a certain point and went, hey, I got to be me?
I think when we started this, we had to be uniquely ourselves. We wanted to be the most authentic that we can.
Yeah.
And here's the real thing that most winemakers, people who own businesses, vintners will not tell you. Nobody drinks the same wine every single night. Stop being selfish. The all tide rises the boats. Or wait, the tide rises all boats. There we go. Yep. There we go.
That's true.
For me, there have been so many instrumental wineries that have made me love wine, made mm-hmm. me like want to go read a book, made me like, oh man, I didn't know this is good. And I mean, even right now, what I'm drinking is this. I don't really like California Chardonnay, but I like Fort Ross Seaview Chardonnay. This, we make Pinot Noir from there, but I have had Chardonnay from there. So somebody mm-hmm. found this for me and I'm like, maybe I don't know shit, right? What do I know? As much as I know, I don't know anything until I taste it, until I share it, until I experience it. And that humility when it comes to the wine world is amazing. It's invigorating. It's mm-hmm. Energetic. It's fun. Especially for me, I'm very competitive. I want to know the most. I want to be the best. I want to do this. But the best is by earning trust every year on the year. And that's the best. You look at some of the best places that are making wine. They've been making wine 10, 15, 20 years. And that's what we want to do at Chosen, is just earn trust over time by the quality of our wines.
Did you have the chosen name at the beginning of wanting to have your own wine label?
Oh, no. That took months. And I had a deep dive what I would like people to understand from this. And then whenever I tell the story, you know, people have a certain feeling about it because it's a sad story, but it's an amazing story. And so the story is, I won a championship in 2016.
Mm-hmm.
We, you know, we're partying. It's the greatest time of my life. Like winning a championship in 2016 was the culmination of my career. And that feeling of like remembering how many hours I put in to just make a basket is crazy. And to, you know, I remember we won, and then the next day I was like looking around like, oh, we don't have another game. We're last. And so that high of the high,
right,
came down to the lowest of the low when my parents died within a month. So my mom died of cancer October, I think 23rd, 24th. And my dad died on Thanksgiving 2016. So that was wild for me as a human being, as a man, as a father, as a son. And so that year, my teammates, my best friends, my family, they became my family. Right? They became the people that started to put coal in my engine. I was a shell of myself. I'm very energetic. I'm very, you know, like right now I've had a coffee, so I'm probably hyped up a little much. But to have people that aren't your family,
right,
take care of you, lift you up, build you up, hold you accountable, do that, they became my chosen family. In the middle of that was most of the time wine, dinners, conversations. And so for chosen family, we, you know, the name comes from when you have a bottle of wine in the middle of a table, people are going to ask, where'd you get it from? Why do you like it? What is it? What is the story? We just want to be a part of your life as a brand once a week, twice a week, whatever that is. Are you watching football? Are you watching Sunday? Are you watching Yellowstone or whatever it is? We just want to be a part of that. We want to earn that trust and be a part of your chosen family. It doesn't have to be always be your brother or sister. It could be your best friend. It could be anything. And that was really important to me and us when we made that name.
If I'm listening correctly, you sound like a seeker in terms of you're very open to wines. You don't just go, this is what I drink, nothing else. You're open to the family, friend situation and that evolving. So it sounds like the chosen brand is just for smarter people. That's what I'm getting.
I think the chosen brand is we have built something and we're trying to continually build it that applies to everyone. You can't talk about being inclusive and you don't have wine that meets a certain price point. You can't talk about being inclusive and you don't make wine from Washington, or you don't make wine from Sonoma Coast or Napa Valley or, you know, Oregon. You cannot be, we want to be the most upfront about, we want to be the most upfront, as is false, and reflective of who we are as people in the wine industry as possible. And that is why we have your upper tier wines that are $60 and above, and we have our lower tier wines that are for somebody introducing themselves into the wine industry. $40 is a lot of money.
Yes.
$40 is a lot of money. And I, you know, certain wine snobs go, oh, $40. But if you don't value that $40, if you're not putting extreme time and nurturing into that $40 bottle of wine, how do you get people into the industry? It seems snooty. It seems I would be contradicting myself if I only made high-end wines, which are easy. You just throw a bunch of expensive oak on it, You get it from the most expensive. You could just throw a bunch of money on it. Instead, what we're trying to do is do the work, do the research, do the blind tasting to take a snapshot of the Willamette Valley so that somebody goes, man, I didn't know. The only thing I knew about Pinot Noir was Meiomi. Now I know what real Pinot Noir tastes like for a budget that fits me. When I go to a grocery store, when I go online, I trust them. And then, you know what? I know Chardonnay doesn't taste like drinking butter from the bottom of a movie popcorn, right? It's fresh. It's acidic. It has a little lemon peels. Like it should be that. It should be reflective of what it really tastes like. And somebody shouldn't have to break their wallet to have an experience like that. And I found that. I found that from other brands. And we are trying to do that as best as possible.
Makes sense to me. So when you talk to entrepreneurs, sometimes they say, oh, you ain't seen nothing yet. We're only at 5% of where we want to be. You're now 3 years into this game. Around what percentage are you towards where you envision where this brand going or where this brand is going? That verb tense was off.
And here's an honest question. I'm, you know, and I have a tattoo of steps, right? On my arm. I can't see what we are going to be in 5 years. I can't do that. I know we're going to have a vineyard. I know we're going to have a tasting room. But for me to just say, oh, we're this, would be doing a disservice to where this may grow. If I'm trying to put the best products out there with the best quality, and here's another industry secret. Between 5 and 10,000, 5 to 7 to 8 gets weird when it comes to quality. So that's a big skip. We're at 3,600. We'll be at 5,000 next year. Where we skip to depends on the marketplace, depends on the places we do, how we want to expand, but the quality has to come first. If we are good at 5,000 and we're selling out and people love it and it's moving like this, it's going to be hard to not stay at that, right?
Right.
But if the demand is so good, if the demand is right, we'll expand. But I don't want to diminish the quality because of one or two people want 10,000 cases instead of 5,000. Does that make sense?
Quality.
I can't mess up. As a basketball player in the wine game, as a retired athlete, as somebody that's quote unquote famous, I can't mess up. Because then, you know what? Everybody in the wine game goes, you know what? I knew it. That's crazy. It's crazy, but I love that pressure. Whether that's rosé, chardonnay, pinot noir, cab, bubbles, syrah, whatever we make, I can't mess up. I have to put as much attention into rosé, which is usually a throwaway thing, that I have to do a cabernet. Because I want to earn respect, and I want to earn respect one wine at a time. And I want people to understand how much I love this industry and how much I love wine and how much the responsibility that I have is to do it right.
That makes sense. Right?
And that's where I'm at. Quality. Sorry to get emotional.
I don't blame you. Well, being mindful of your time here, the last thing that I want to know is when I grew up as a devoted, diehard NBA fan, now that I think about it, all we knew about the players was basketball, and that was it. We didn't know what they were into when they were off the court. And now you, a world champion, hopefully one day the Hall of Fame thing happens. We'll see that. But now we're seeing success in the wine world. I'm seeing a Star Wars shirt. What is your number three besides, family, wine, sports. What's your number three? Are you a big music, movie, film person like I think you are?
Oh, man. I am a huge comic book nerd. I grew up collecting comics. I have on my phone now with technology, I have about 2,500 comic books from Marvel. No offense to DC. I think for me, you always want to live through something, right? And, yeah. And for me, I like living through these characters, how they evolve, how they grow, whether that's X-Men or the Avengers or X-Force with Deadpool or whatever that is. I yeah. love that the lore of that, right? Whether that's anime and that's, you know, yeah, I mean, I can go on, you know, Hunter x Hunter or, you know, Naruto or Boruto or whatever that is. I think for me, it's something that I connect with my kids with, mm-hmm. right? It's something that we can watch. It's something that I can explain to them as an adult why the adult figure did this. And it's fun, or especially now, anime. I love movies. I travel so much. I watch every single movie. I just watched Black Adam. I thought it was trash.
What I was expecting to hear, because that one was years in the making.
I just thought it was trash. I think you're doing a disservice to that character. He's not this nice guy. He's not, what is he? Again, right. I thought Marvel did a better job with Namor than DC did with Black Adam. If Kondak was the most important thing, mm-hmm. he would act differently. He would not be whatever, you know, blah, blah, blah. Anyways, sorry, I'm gonna go on a tangent. But for me, I think comic book movies and Marvel movies and all these movies are extremely important because kids have something to look up to that may look like them, may be them, mm-hmm. right? Whether that's a white kid or a black kid or Asian kid or Hispanic kid, they look up to that and they go, this guy, like, I want to be X person.
That's a really healthy way of looking at it all. And that's definitely, Hollywood has definitely stepped it up in the last 20 years in terms of the diversity of the characters. Like, for example, I don't think Black Panther would have been made 20 years ago. The Green Hornet was a step in the right direction with Kano and all that. But good points, man.
But here's the thing. People forget about Blade. If Blade wasn't so successful, you would have never got Black Panther. Blade was the first Black movie that did well. Black superhero. Blade is part of the Marvel universe.
Yeah, nobody remembers. Meteor Man did not do what it should have done.
Meteor Man is, like, you know, funny, but it ain't real. But, you know, again, it's just there are so many different stories, yeah. and these characters evolve. Tell us these stories, whether Kang the Conqueror, now that's coming out. If you didn't watch Loki, or if you didn't watch, you know, whatever that is, I'm watching all these things because I'm literally watching a comic book in real time.
Well said. Well, hey, congratulations on the success of your wine label. And thank I you. Say that because so many people say, I want to do this. They do the first run, they quit. You, 3 years, still going, like everything you do, long-term projects. So I'm looking forward to seeing where you are in 5 years.
Thank you. Same here. You know, we're looking at vineyards right now. I think for me, this was part of our plan. I always wanted my kids to be able to walk through a vineyard with no shoes on and put their feet on the ground and say, this is mine. You know, that's extremely important to me, but I want to make sure that it is the right place. I want to make sure that we're making great wine from there. And anybody listening, I want you to just, your dollars count for us, right? Whether that's $10, $15, $20, whatever that is. You know, when you're in the alcohol industry or the wine industry, I don't expect you to drink Chosen every night, right? I don't, and I'm the owner, like, obviously. I just want to be a part of your life. I want you to trust me. I want you to trust that I'm doing the work, regardless of what I was before this. I want you to understand that I am now a vintner. And so I'm working with the right people. We value your time. We value who you want to hang out with. And we don't want to put anything on your table that you don't appreciate, where you go, ah, this isn't it. We want you to say, this is it. And I want to share this with somebody that you love. So.
Amen. Channing, thank you for your time. Thank you, man. Continued success at you.
Yeah, appreciate it. Paltrocast.